Then I move to the boring part. Okay, so I'm going to talk about underpinnings of China's high quality development. You can see the style is very different. This is black white right now. Okay, so I think I have just two messages to share with distinguished audience. First of all, I think from last year's CPC, National Congress, and also the Central Economic Work Meeting, and this year's Lianghui, two sessions, I think one of the key phrases is high quality development. So people have been talking about this actually is very crucial for China going forward. China has to go through this process, has to transfer the development model from fast growth to high quality development. So I think this actually is a very important judgment about the current situation, and it's also going to generate a lot of implications for the economy, for industries and for companies in China and also abroad. So I think I'm going to first of all say a little bit about why this is so important right now. Everybody knows that in the past 40 years, China has achieved a lot of economic miracles. Just a couple of highlights. For example, the total size of the economy has increased more than 34 times in 40 years. And GDP per capita increased from $200 to more than $9,000 in 40 years. That is a great achievement. In the meantime, China has almost complete the industrialization process. And China has invested probably the most expanding high-speed railway, highway network in the world. So infrastructure has been solidly established in China in the past 40 years. And I think if people talk about what China has done right, I always say that, look, this probably is the so-called secret. Number one, I think China has been relying on a growth model with a huge focus on infrastructure. And that actually is a very, very effective strategy for China's industrialization. And also, China has been a very active participant of the global value chain system. And in the meantime, the finance has been very supportive. I mean, even though people argue that it's not always efficient, but at least it injects a huge amount of capital into the real economy to help the economy jumpstart. So I think that is a very important lessons we have learned in the past. But in the meantime, I think we are seeing some structural problems. Number one, I think, is that the total factory productivity is declining, mainly because China has almost complete the industrialization. So I think we are basically entering into a new stage. In this stage, it's getting harder to generate a higher level of TFP growth rate, which has been argued by developing economists, is the most important driver of GDP per capita. And I think another thing is that if you look at, I'll skip this one. If you look at another important thing, capital efficiency, which can be measured by return on invested capital at a firm level, I think is declining. The idea is very simple because we are growing really fast in the past four decades, and so we complete industrialization. But now we're getting into a stage in which the marginal return of capital is declining. So basically, this is economic principle. So we're getting into a stage where ROIC is declining. So I think this is pretty much the reason we're talking about high quality development. I always use this identity as a framework to understand the challenges facing China's economy. Because growth can be driven by two things. One is investment rate. The other one is investment efficiency, which can be measured by return on invested capital, ROIC here. So we're seeing that because return on invested capital is declining in China, so going forward, if China wants to maintain fast growth as in the past, China will have to rely more on investment rate. So investment rate will be very important. So I think that is a dilemma. So if we set our growth target too high, then we're going to push up the investment rate. And the investment rate has been supported by credits, by bank lending. So that is going to create a lot of constraint on the commercial banking system's health. For example, last year, everybody knows that the economic figure is quite decent, quite outstanding. The GDP growth rate is 6.9%. But in the meantime, we note that the total social financing has increased by 19.4 trillion RMB. So we use 19.4 trillion RMB of finance to generate less than 6 trillion RMB of GDP net increment, which means that the marginal impact of monetary policy of credit has been declining. That is because the return on invested capital is declining in China. So I think that is a big background why Chinese government is talking about high quality development. If we continue to rely on investment rate, that is going to generate a lot of liquidity, a lot of bad debt issue in the economy. Everybody knows that, the data is not new, it's outdated, but even based on the 2014 information, you can see how serious the situation is. For example, by the first half of 2014, the corporate debt has amounted to 125% of GDP in China, which is very high. People estimate that as of last year, this ratio, the total corporate debt as a percentage of GDP probably has reached 160% or even higher in China. So that is a big problem. So if China wants to continue its fast growth, it has to rely on investment rate. And that will, force the corporate debt to increase. And then it's going to be very, very difficult to deleverage, even though the government has been taking deleveraging as one of the top priorities in the recent years. So I think that is a big problem. So I think if you look at what happened, the key phrase is that we need high quality development. And this year, the three top campaigns for government, for central government, and also for local government, I think one of the most talked about one is how to address the accumulating systemic risk in the financial sector. We have three. This is one. The other one is alleviation of poverty, and the third one is the blue sky, project. How to recover blue sky in China. So among the top, the three top priorities, I take this one as the most difficult one, mainly because it's closely associated with the economic development model of China, which China has been adopting, have been using in the past four decades. So I think, this is becoming one of the challenges, right? Now, how to address the accumulating systematic risk in financial sector. I think I'm going to, first of all, talk about the source, where they come from, why we have this kind of problem. And after that, I think once we understand the source, we know the solution. We just try to come up with policy initiatives and also some other things to deal with, to get rid of the sources, and then we are done. I think there are three sources. The first one is about the corporate sector in China. I would argue that after 40 years of fast growth, the corporate sector of China has entered into a stage in which it's getting very big, very huge. But in the meantime, the investment efficiency, the return on invested capital is not very high. So, I call this weak economic microstructure. That is one big source. The second source is that I think in China still, even after we have been developing market-based economy for almost four decades, but still we have a lot of misperceptions about some of the key economic and finance concepts. So we have a lot of misperceptions about finance. we always believe that the more finance, the better, but actually it's wrong, because really, what really matters here is what kind of finance we have, what kind of financial structure would be better for us to serve the economic development. So I think we need to sort out those misperceptions. This is the second source. The third source is about the institutional weaklies. Still, I think in China, we found that we still lack a very effective pricing mechanism. In that sense, I think the pricing is not very efficient. That generates huge room for arbitrage, regulatory arbitrage, and some types of arbitrage. That make the market, stock market, and also the whole financial system not that efficient in terms of allocating resources among competing ends. So that's a third source. Probably I'm going to just give you a couple of slides. You can get a flavor of what they mean and how they generate additional systemic financial risk in China. The first part, about the corporate sector, right? I mentioned that it's not very efficient in terms of using capital. I have two figures to demonstrate here. Number one, if you talk about ROIC, return on invested capital, we did some research. In the past 15 years, the average return on invested capital in China for Chinese North Asia listed companies is just about 3 to 4%. So which means that for every $1 of capital put into this company's operation, it is able to generate 3 cents to 4 cents of after-tax profit. It's quite low. International comparison, look at the US in the past 100 years, this figure is 10%. So that is, I think, is one figure. The other thing is this one. If you look at the ROE histogram of the Chinese listed companies in the recent 3 years, from 2014 to 2016, this is a very weird distribution, right? Everybody with some basic knowledge about statistics would believe that it should be normal distribution, has bear shape, right? For example, this is US for the same time period, more or less like a bear shape. But in China, it's, this is Chinese firms. What I want to say is that the quality is a big problem. Within, I think, 27 years, the number of public companies has increased from zero to more than 3,000. That is a huge achievement. But in the meantime, I think the future improvement will come from the quality. If somehow we can change the quality of the corporate sector going forward, I think the first source of financial risk will be naturally resolved. So that is, I think, the first thing. The second thing is about misperception about finance. For example, I mentioned this. If you talk to a lot of local government officials, they would argue that the finance industry would be the pillar industry for our province or our cities going forward. What you are saying here is the ratio of finance value added to GDP. So, the higher the ratio, which means that finance as an industry is more important in the whole national economy in terms of the output, right? So the blue one is China, the green, the red one is the U.S. If you compare two countries, you can see that in recent years, China has overtaken U.S. To have a more significant finance industry in its economy. The ratio in U.S. is about 7.4% in recent years. In China, I think last year is 8%. The year before last year is 8.4%. The year before last year and the last year it was 8.5%. So which means that finance has been, if we take this as an indicator of how developed finance is, you can argue that China has a better finance, right? More developed finance than US. But still, people feel that it's still very difficult and also very costly for certain portions of the economy to get financing. So which means that this actually is not quite right. Because if you think about how people calculate finance value added, I mean, in national output accounting system, it measures the salary, the bonus, the profit, the rents of a finance industry, including finance employees, bankers. So the higher the ratio basically means that the more costly, right? The more costly, the higher fees the finance industry charge the real sector, which means that it's not necessarily a good indicator of how efficient your financial system is supporting your economy. So that is my point. I actually did some analysis. This is research unpublished yet, but hopefully it can be published in one of the good journals in the world. I team up with my PhD students at Guanghua. We look at different finance. So for example, if you just look at the financial assets as a percentage of GDP, you take this as the right-hand side of variable, you find that the more finance, the better, because it is able to improve the efficiency level of resource allocation. If you look at the first column, right, this is significant. But if you divide the finance into two types, one is government-driven, the other one is market-based. So here, government-driven basically means that we did some technical analysis. We use the fiscal imbalance as a driver of finance. We found that that portion actually has a negative effect on the efficient level of resource allocation. On the other hand, the market-based finance actually has a very positive impact on the efficiency level. So I think this a tale of two finances basically means that in China we need more market-based finance rather than government-driven finance. And if you argue that the key challenge for Chinese economy going forward is to improve ROIC, improve the efficiency level of capital usage, then having more market-based finance is the key. So I think this research basically generated some insights on that perspective. Finally, I think just very quick, I'm not going to elaborate too much on this because probably for some people it sounds too direct. But I would say that the financial system right now cannot price the risk in a proper way. For example, if you talk about two companies, private company versus no SOE, if they have the same credit risk, they should be priced similarly, right? But in China, I think in general, on average, the interest rate charged on SOEs will be slightly lower than the interest rate charged on private companies. But unfortunately, majority of the SOEs are not that efficient in terms of allocating the resources. So that actually is a dilemma. On the one hand, you allocate a lot of resources to this particular sector, but on the other hand, this sector is not generating very high level of return on invested capital. So you put them together, you are seeing our economy, which is still growing very fast, but in the meantime, the fundamentals are not that solid, a lot of that healthy. So I think how to address these issues. These are my takeaways, very quick. First of all, I think going forward, if we promote high quality development, it implies that we need new breeds of companies. So when we evaluate what kind of companies are good going forward, we're not going to use the word like size, number of employees, total revenue. So probably going forward, we're going to use the terms such as how much value you can generate, how high a level of return on invested capital you have, etc. So China needs new breed of company. I think the good news is that we're seeing the surge of those kind of companies in China. Right now, people are talking about the new four inventions in China, like the Alipay, online payment system, sharing economy, high-speed train, etc. I think some of the companies will emerge from those sectors, and they have different implications for the macrostructure of the Chinese economy. And the second thing is that to address the financial risk, I think we need to understand the source. So going forward, I think three things are very important. Number one, we have to change our macrostructure. We have to improve return on invested capital. Number two, maybe we should have a new approach to understanding financial development. What we need is not more finance. What we need is better finance. And the better finance in China right now can be defined as more market-based finance. And also, I want to talk about the institutional infrastructure, such as to have rating agencies to correctly evaluate credit risk of different market participants in the economy. And also for local government, I didn't have time to elaborate, local government that has been one of the source of the financial risk in China. For local government, maybe it's time to have balance sheets, to have an income statement, to have market-based credit ratings. So based on those market-based indicators, probably the central government can better evaluate the performance of local government officials. And eventually, I think they can provide right incentives for local government to develop the economy and also to have a balanced development in a certain region or certain cities. So I think those are the so-called policy implications. And at the end of the day, it's always about people. So I think having more entrepreneurs, having more market oriented executives, decision makers is always the key. So hopefully Guanghua as a business school, we can continue to play our share in this process. And I also hope that going forward, we have more and more people come together. We research on those critical issues in China and also abroad. We come up with solutions and we invest together to have a much better tomorrow. So that is my interpretation of Liang Hui. Thank you very much. Really appreciate it. Thanks.